I can imagine myself, no, what are you doing? You're putting some...
Yeah, I used to think that when I was really little. I mean, you don't start receiving it until you're 14 and older, the ashes. But since you're little and you look up and stuff like that, it's like, what is that? The only thing I could associate it with was cremation, and I thought they were people. And I would tell people, you've got a person on your forehead. But then I realized they're actually the palms burned from the previous Palm Sunday.
Palm Sunday.
So just to reaffirm everybody, ashes, it's not people ashes, but palm ashes.
The palms that were blessed for last
yes.
Palm Sunday.
Yes.
And Joy, I understand at the campus ministry in Edinburgh, mm-hmm. you actually burnt some palms from last...
Yeah, we started, we did it last year, and it was out of necessity because it was too close to order ashes from any, you know, or to buy or to get any. So what do we do? Well, in cleaning, I found some old palms, and I said, oh, perfect. So then we burned them, and so now we had some left over last year, so we're going to continue to burn them. So to continue that tradition, and we'll mix them together. That way, it'll be the palms from the previous Sunday, continuing that tradition. You know, our church is full of traditions. We love traditions, so why not, you know, why change that tradition?
Awesome. Fantastic. And speaking of traditions, there are a lot of traditions that tie into this season of Lent. And we're going to talk a little bit about some of those that are kind of at the surface of things, and then some other more creative or even weird ideas of things that people can do for Lent. You found a cool website that
yeah.
you can share with our audience, Ruby?
Yeah, from LifeTeen, just to touch up on the weird ones, you know, the weird things to do, because, I mean, well, you've got your... Well, your normal ones, you've got your, like this one says, this year this year I'm giving up shoes as often as possible. I still wear shoes even if I'm doing a work project or if I have to fly on a plane, but I'm going to avoid going to places that require shoes. And that's coming from a missionary from LifeTeen. So another one's, I'm addicted to caffeine, so I give up all drinks but water for Lent.
And those are the usual ones.
Those are usual ones.
The Cokes,
the
sweets.
The just fast food, you know. But I know Angel, diocesan staff, Angel, he's been on the show a couple of times, Angel Barrera. He said that...
Hey, Angel.
Hey. Well, he said that he gave up cheese for Lent, and I was like, really, are you like allergic or something?
He attempted to give up cheese many times. I think he achieved it once or a couple of times, but yeah. he attempted... I remember back when we were in high school, he gave up cheese. And for those, just a little backstory, when we go to CCD there in our parish back in Mission, they have really good burritos with the nacho cheese on them. And so we would just kind of accustomed, like, hey, we're here at CCD, now it's time. So we would always have burritos or nachos and stuff like that. So it was, he gave up cheese. And I know we tried, because I tried doing it too, many times. And then it's just, we go Wednesday, and it's like, ah!
It's right there. You just had to, right?
But he did succeed a couple times.
Yeah,
that's before we recorded that episode on Facing Temptation.
Yes. that was when we were in high school before.
Yeah. But yeah, he would give up cheese, and he gave up cheese in like for Lent, I don't know if it was a couple years ago, mm-hmm. I guess. But yeah, and then now he said he doesn't really eat it very often. Mm-hmm. But I thought it was weird to give up cheese, but
it just depends on you
and how
and what it is. And like when we said weird, they're not weird. I don't know if y'all understand weird. It's just kind of, oh, not the usual sweets, soda,
yeah.
mm-hmm. you know, or mm-hmm. stuff like that. But so a little bit more, like there was one that said, I'm going to pray a rosary. And I'm going to do a crunch for every word or for every Hail Mary.
Says, pray the Hail Mary and do an app crunch for every single word. So it's more a weird one. Says, don't eat the last bite of your food. Park at the very back of the parking lot. Don't use utensils. When you wake up, jump out of bed, kiss the floor, and learn humility.
Wow. Park at the very back of the parking lot.
Well, yeah.
I think that's pretty cool.
Well,
that's like...
Because we're always driving and
wanting the
parking lot sharks. I know at UTPA, they, like, people will follow you and, hi, are you going to park? Let me give you a ride. And no, stranger. Like, you know, there's always that issue of trying
too.
To find that closest parking spot.
Parking lot sharks.
Yeah. But if you look at that, you know, it says park in the very back. by you parking in the very back, let's see what happens. Well, one, you're freeing up a spot for somebody else. Mm-hmm. All right? Because a lot of the times, you know, oh, I'm going to give up sweets or I'm going to give up this, but there's two, there's an intrinsic, mm-hmm. you know, reason, a very egocentric reason. Oh, well, if I give up sweets, then I'm going to lose some weight. Mm-hmm. Or if I don't give up caffeine, I know it's not good for me. And so who's really benefiting it? And is that really bringing you closer to God? But mm-hmm. if we take this parking lot thing, you park in the back, you're freeing it up for somebody else. So you have to walk more. So there's some suffering there. And you're offering it up for somebody else. Now, you have to do that, or that has to be your intention. Don't just park in the back and I'm going to park in the back and oh, now I'm in the back and I have to walk all this way and I got to go. Mm-hmm. But to do it, again, we've talked about motives and the reasons behind we do things a lot on this show before, because that's what drives us and that's what makes us do things. So yes, park in the back, but then walk to the store with a smile, or park to school and walk
because
with a
smile. Because parking in the back and saying, well, I'm going to, you know, there's an added benefit. I'm going to walk more, and I'm going to, that shouldn't mm-hmm. be the driver. What you're saying, it should be the giving it up for somebody else.
Mm-hmm. That's really
cool.
And even the suffering, like, mm-hmm. it's hot today. I'm going to feel the heat. I'm going to, and offer it up. I say, mm-hmm. God, I know it's hot, but I'm going to walk, and I'm going to do it. And do it, I don't want to say joyfully, but do it, don't do it with a negative attitude. Yeah. Do it with mm-hmm. an acceptance and accepting it with joy, not just like, yes, I get to walk today, you know, but.
Sure.
Well,
and
go ahead. Well, there was one, I was actually looking at these lists, and there was one that actually just really got to me because, well, I'm a girl, and with girls, we have to be nice. We have to do our hair and stuff like that. So one of the weird ones said, don't straighten or curl your hair. I automatically just went to my hair. I was like, no, I can't. I can't give that up. And Joe was like, he was like, well, imagine, how long does it take for you to do your hair in the morning? How long does it take for you to straighten your hair? I was like, 5-10 minutes. How long does it take to curl your hair? 10 to 15, more or less. So he's like, imagine, all that time multiplied it by the days of the week, imagine how much time you would have, and you can just offer that up and do something, you
do
know,
intentional
like
prayer. The math that we worked out is about 30 minutes a week, kind of being generous, 30 minutes a week. But so don't do your hair that way, but then do 30 minutes of intentional prayer to mm-hmm. do it. Yeah. Another one with the same mentality is, you know, I'm going to give up fast food. Well, now let's look at it. How many times do you eat fast food? Let's say it's just for lunch Monday through Friday. Conservatively speaking, $5, 5 times 5, 25. Well, then use those $25
to put it
in the collection basket. Take it, feed the needy, mm-hmm. or you know, donate it to a charitable cause. But something that we kind of see very top level, and then, you know, we are young adults, guys. We have to mature. We're not high school students. We got to step it up. So going a little bit deeper, if you can, mm-hmm. and then that to help you being closer to God, or what's going to bring you or increase your faith, because that's the ultimate goal of all the sacrifice.
And I'm glad you're touching on this, because indeed the ultimate goal is not you know, what am I inflicting on myself or what is this suffering, but how is this going to bring me closer to God? And you know, one of the points that was mentioned is we may think that we have to give up something, but in reality, we can also offer something, do something differently, do more of mm-hmm. something. Mm-hmm. Would you touch on some of these ideas?
Well, yeah. And I'm glad you bring it up, because when we go to Mass, if you don't go to Mass, go to Mass, please. If you need to find a place, go to cm.net or cdob.org, and you can find a parish. But when we go to Mass and we stand up there in the penitential rite, that word comes up again, say, I confess, and we say things like, for what I have done, for what I have failed to do in my thoughts and in my words, you know, we can go into mm-hmm. that on another show. But for what I have done and for what I have failed to do. So it's not necessarily just, oh, I'm going to give up, like you said, but what can I do? Because mm-hmm. if we look at Jesus Christ and his ministry, it was when he would heal people, he always called them to action. He healed the paralytic, and what did he say? Get up, roll up your mat, and go home. Mm-hmm. The blind, you know, he spit on the floor, made mud with his saliva, put it on his face, go wash it off. It was always go do something. So we're always, you know, in his ministry, we're called to do also. So don't get stuck with the tradition or the misconception where I have to give up something and just plainly stay with that, but do something.
Go visit the poor. Go visit, take food to the hungry, the imprisoned. Go visit the sick. Go, something that we can do.
Go visit an old friend that you haven't seen in a long time. Call somebody that you've been mm-hmm. meaning to call. Or, we always bump into somebody in HEB or something and say, hey, oh, I was meaning to call you. Well, why didn't you? And so these are the things that you can kind of do, again, to build the community and to build up the kingdom of God.
One thing you can also do is, for yourself, to prepare yourself, is to maybe pray more. Pray the rosary, Divine Mercy Chaplet, or read a couple chapters of the Bible. Read them with your family, like your siblings, your parents, your friends. Something that you can do together. So you can
choose a good spiritual book mm-hmm. to say, during these 40 days, I'm going to read this book. Mm-hmm.
Or the UCAT, or something that will just help you grow spiritually and prepare you for
that. You mentioned the UCAT. Would you mind pulling that up there, Joe, and kind of sharing with our audience what the UCAT is? Yeah.
The UCAT, well, just a quick overview. About 20 years ago, the church kind of put out the Catechism of the Catholic Church, and it's the teachings that we have that we use, or that the church teaches us. But last year, the Pope had commissioned this. This is the UCAT, and it's put in words for the youth, for young adults, for us to understand, because the Catechism was written by theologians and people were
pretty
educated. And it's very dense. Sometimes you have to read it a couple times. So just the UCAT, it's written in simpler terms.
It's got pictures.
It's got a little flip, little man that on the corner. So use that. But another thing you can take up is, this is a time where you can say, you know what, I've been meaning to join the Knights of Columbus. I've been meaning to go to a Bible study. That small that community group, that looks pretty good. Couples for Christ. Yeah.
Play
young adult groups there at the cathedral. This is the time. This is the time to step up and to really do something. We've mentioned what to give up and what to do, and that's what this season is really meant for.
And one thing that we do with our CM office, for those of you guys who have been thought of signing up for our newsletter, do so. I mean, every month we have a young adult group spotlight. Like one of the mm-hmm. groups that we mentioned, there's information on there with their mission, who they reach out to, and who to get in contact with. If all this contemplating about joining, why don't you just join? You learn something from it, seriously, you guys. So every time, sign up for our newsletter and our monthly newsletter, and you'll see all the different things that we can offer you and things that will help you grow spiritually. So join a youth group also.
Young adult group. Yeah, young adult. If you are a young adult wanting to connect, wanting a community of faith, or don't know where to go, where to turn to, give us a call. Shoot us an email, visit our website, cymcyam.net, and we will help you connect with a community of young adults, be it at a campus ministry, at a parish group, some of our diocesan activities. We are here to serve you. So we've had a great conversation about Lent. May this be a time that brings you closer to Christ. God bless you, and we will see you again in Young Adult Matters.